Blackstone Publishing presents One Drum, Stories and Ceremonies for a Planet by Richard Wagamese. This book is read by Christian Baskous. A note from the publisher. Richard Wagamese was working on this manuscript in the 3 years prior to his death. Regrettably, he did not have time to fulfill his original plan to write stories and ceremonies inspired by each of the foundational teachings of the Ojibwe tradition, the seven grandfather teachings. Still, the manuscript has much to offer readers, and it has been published here as the author penned it, with minimal edits. As Wagamese wrote, he was not a traditionalist, but merely one who has trudged the same path many of this human family has, the path of the seeker called forward by a yearning I have not always understood. In this book, Richard Wagamese gives us four small, doable ceremonies, ceremonies for people of all cultures and beliefs. And it was his hope that in following them, readers would be inspired to connect with the rest of humanity and every other living thing on the planet, and live life itself as a ceremony. It is our hope that the reader will draw inspiration from these writings and find their own path, filling in what Wagamese did not have the chance to put down on paper. For as he wrote in these pages, within each of us is a shaman. Within each of us is a teacher. Within each of us is a storyteller. These are powerful roles that are vital to our collective survival. And as Wagamese also wrote, a ceremony is not complete until it is shared. In keeping with that idea, it seems fitting that here is his final manuscript, shared. Grandfather, look at our brokenness. We know that we are the ones who are divided, and we are the ones who must come back together to worship and walk in a sacred way. That by our affirmation, we must heal the earth and heal each other. From Songs for the People, Art Solomon, Ojibwe Elder. Forward. When I think of Seminole writers who have taken it upon themselves to document the journey of Canada's Indigenous people and had the ability to change society's impression, only a handful come to mind, including Thompson Highway, Lee Miracle, Thomas King, and of course, Richard Wagamese. Richard and I were friends, not best friends, as he lived on the other side of the country and had interests that differed from mine. But we would still greet each other warmly when a literary festival or conference would put us in the same hotel. Once, when on a trip into my territory, he and his partner stopped in at my reserve for a visit. I managed to convince them to break their cleanse and enjoy some organic, cruelty-free sausages I was barbecuing. I felt oddly delighted at that slight act of corruption. Oh, and if you want to hear a funny story about Richard's underwear and then mine, feel free to ask Sheila Rogers. I can see you smiling already. But more importantly, I was a fan of both the man and his work. Richard had talent and a unique style. While quick to smile, and his whole face would light up when that smile chose to appear. He was perhaps known for the seriousness of his work, a survivor of cross-cultural adoption policies, frequently known as the scoop-up. Richard was an unparalleled spokesman for those who suffer from what I call post-contact stress disorder. His work, fiction and nonfiction alike, told the story of entire generations of Indigenous people who were commonly at odds with the Canadian dream. His mastery and control of the written language was something to envy. Though in our communities, both English and print were invasive species, Richard had the talent to indigenize it to the point of giving his writing its own status card. More importantly, Richard was not just a writer or a storyteller, he was a philosopher, though such a moniker would no doubt have made him blush. Upon reading his work, especially this new book, it occurs to me that the way he thought and strung those thoughts together, binding his own personal experiences with those of our elders' teachings, could only come from a mind that had lived a life like his. Good and bad journeys. Mixing in the mind that created the literary legacy that includes Starlight, Embers, Indian Horse, and this, his final collection of personal thoughts. One Drum explores the seven grandfather teachings, an investigation into what many Anishinaabe consider the seven fundamental truths of living a good and productive life. As is his usual style, Richard wanders through traditional teachings, bittersweet reflections, and a desire to understand how it all ties together. Unfortunately, he only managed to complete his interpretation of the first three. One can only wonder what else he would have had to say about the rest. Alas, one of the great unanswered questions in the universe. Still, we should be grateful that we have this last glimpse into the thoughts of Richard Wagamese. I sometimes wonder if it was musings like this that helped keep some of his monsters at bay. He had demons that haunted him, but perhaps that was what helped fuel some of his genius. I can't say, but I can say his characters were all so real, and yet so literary, and always as complex as he was. I, too, view the world through stories. Just recently, I was in Bremen, Germany, attending a small authors' festival. I managed to sneak away to see some of the city and found myself walking along a large park. Nestled not far inside, I found a nice restaurant. Realizing I was hungry, I decided to partake. The waitress, a young woman, possibly on either side of 20, asked where I was from. Upon finding out Canada, she eagerly mentioned she was taking a literary course and was currently reading a book called Indian Horse. I literally did a double take. She seemed so delighted that I knew not only the book, but also the author, whom she greatly admired. Richard's fans were and are international. While having their origins in Anishinaabe culture, the teachings of the seven grand.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.